breaking news that could shed light on whether the President of the United States talked about possibly obstructing justice with the nation's top law enforcement official at the time. Today, former Acting Attorney General Matthew Whitaker met with the top Democrat and Republican on the House Judiciary Committee. Now, according to committee chairman Jerry Nadler, who's a Democrat, Whitaker talked about what the president said to him in the wake of Michael Cohen's guilty plea about his former fixer, as well as the Southern District of New York's investigation of Cohen and the man known as Individual One in court documents, also known as the president. However, the top Republican congressman, Doug Collins, says that's not what Whitaker said. Discussing either of those things, especially with the man at least nominally in charge of them, raises questions about whether the president was trying to exert influence, perhaps unlawfully. Now, remember, during public hearings last month, Whitaker refused to discuss what, if anything, the president said to him. He did, however, address one very specific question.
Did the president lash out at you after Michael Cohen's guilty plea for lying to Congress about a Trump Organization project to build a tower in Moscow?
The president specifically tweeted that he had not lashed out.
I'm asking you, Mr. Whitaker, did the president lash out at you? I'm not asking what he tweeted. I don't have a lot of confidence in the veracity of his tweets. I'm asking you under oath.
Congressman, that is based on an unsubstantiated...
Sir, answer the question yes or no. Did the president lash out to you about Mr. Cohen's guilty plea?
No, he did not.
So, according to the former acting attorney general, President Trump did not, quote, lash out at him. The real question, though, is just what did the president say? And that's what tonight's new reporting could shed light on. I say could because it's in question, seeing as Justice Correspondent Laura Jarrett starts us off. So what exactly did Whitaker say today? And again, according to Chairman Nadler's accounting of events.
Well, Anderson, Nadler says that Whitaker didn't deny that the president called him to discuss the case of his former lawyer, Michael Cohen, and other personnel decisions in the Southern District of New York. A little bit vague there about what exactly was discussed. And Nadler also says that Whitaker's involved in conversations about the recusal of U.S. Attorney Jeffrey Berman in the Southern District of New York and whether prosecutors there went too far in pursuing the campaign finance. As you said, it goes to the question of whether the president was trying to put his thumb on the scale in some way or influence the investigations into Cohen where he was directly implicated. And in some cases, Whitaker was on the receiving end of these calls, as we've reported, and may be the only one who really knows what happened.
So the ranking member on the committee, Congressman Doug Collins, Republican, he disputes almost the entirety of this account, correct?
That's right. We've got two diametrically opposed versions of Whitaker here. Collins says that Nadler's reading into Whitaker's testimony, pushed back on Nadler's characterization of their interview, downplaying what Whitaker told the committee, and saying there's simply no evidence that Whitaker discussed the Cohen case with the president. But interestingly, my colleagues Manu Raju and Jeremy Erb on the Hill report tonight that Whitaker thought that some of the campaign finance charges against Cohen were, quote, specious, pointing to the failed effort to prosecute former Senator John Edwards on similar charges, and this is according to GOP aides who were in the room, Anderson.
I don't quite understand how, you know, Nadler and you know, the Democrat and the Republican can have such diametrically opposed accountings of what Whitaker actually said and the meaning of it. I mean, is the transcript going to get released? Is there going to be any way to tell what Whitaker actually said?
Well, unfortunately for us, this was behind closed doors today. There is no transcript. So, like most things in life, I think it's going to come down to a credibility determination and whose side you believe and which one sounds more like the facts. Anderson.
All right, Laura Jarrett, thanks. You'll recall this question of whether the president asked his acting attorney general to take action against the Southern District. It has come up before, such as this moment, not long after Whitaker's testimony.
Did you ask Acting Attorney General Matthew Whitaker to change the leadership of the investigation into your former personal attorney, Michael Cohen?
No, not at all. I don't know who gave you that. That's more fake news. There's a lot of fake news out there.
So does the president still believe that, seeing as Caitlin Collins joins us now from the White House? So what's the White House saying about this?
So far, Anderson, no official statement from the White House about this, but expect them to point to what the Republican in the room is saying about all of this. His version of events, as Laura just laid out, totally downplaying what Chairman Nadler had to describe this as, saying it's not nefarious, and then Whitaker actually didn't reveal anything new about his conversations with the president, saying that he only had conversations with his staff about the Cohen probe. But of course, because there is no transcript, it's going to be one of those things where it's a he said, he said, whatever their version of this events are. So the White House will be able to use those talking points from Doug Collins, the Republican, and be able to say them without them being checked against any transcript of what Matt Whitaker actually said.
And according to your reporting, the president was very unhappy that Whitaker had to testify in front of Congress in the first place.
Oh, yeah. He did not like seeing Matt Whitaker get grilled by the Democrats on that committee. He actually liked Doug Collins because Doug Collins, in his view of things, pointed out what he said was an absurd testimony that he was having to give. And the president also didn't like his relationship with Matt Whitaker coming under such scrutiny. Now, Whitaker would not answer questions about the president lashing out at him, only pointing to the president's tweet. Though, of course, we know from our reporting that that happened not just once, but twice when the president was rattled by those developments in the Michael Cohen probe in New York.
All right. Caitlin Collins from the White House. Caitlin, thanks very much. I want to get reaction now from leading voice on the Senate Judiciary Committee. Senator Richard Blumenthal of Connecticut joins me. Senator, I'm wondering what you make of this. I mean, if Chairman Nadler's account of this is correct, and Whitaker did not, in fact, deny the president called him to discuss the Michael Cohen case, what does that say to you?
What it says to me is that the president was attempting to influence potentially that investigation in New York, where he was an unindicted co-conspirator. In effect, he was called individual number one, but clearly he was that person in a possible campaign finance conspiracy involving Michael Cohen. The only way to really reconcile these two accounts from Collins and Nadler is to take an earlier version from the Republican counsel, who said that Whitaker insisted he could not remember any conversation with the president. Perhaps Congressman Collins means by do not remember that, in effect, he denied those conversations. But Chairman Nadler has been very clear. He says that there was a conversation, as indicated by the fact that Whitaker did not deny it.
So is it clear to you, though, what exactly is being alleged? That Nadler saying he didn't deny that there was a conversation, the idea that the president was talking about personnel issues in the Southern District of New York, which I assume, you know, I mean, the biggest personnel issue is the fact that the recusal by the person that he appointed to head the Southern District of New York related to the Cohen case. I guess, is there any way to find out what was said in that meeting? I mean, is it possible the transcript should be released or would be released?
The transcript should be released, just like I've insisted that the entire Mueller report should be released. And very possibly, Matt Whitaker should be brought back before the committee in public under oath. Chairman Nadler is a very careful and meticulous attorney, and he uses words carefully. There is a lot of smoke here, which indicates fire, more questions than answers, and very likely there needs to be a release of this transcript, but also more testimony to establish exactly what Whitaker's saying, because he seemingly is playing both sides of this street in a very disingenuous way.
So even if the president did call Whitaker and talked about the Cohen case, if no action was actually taken by Whitaker, is there any issue in terms of legality of it?
There is very definitely an issue. If the president called the acting Attorney General of the United States about an ongoing investigation of him in the Southern District of New York, where he was named as, in effect, an unindicted co-conspirator, any sort of conversation would be wildly improper and evidence of potential obstruction of justice, even if nothing came of it in terms of Whitaker Act. Clearly, the president's intent in calling Whitaker was to influence the outcome. Clearly, that kind of attempt, whether it produced action on Whitaker's part, was improper, verging on outright obstruction of justice. So this report is potentially explosive. Whitaker has denied very specifically in his opening statement in public that kind of conversation. But even some backtracking indicates that perhaps there was such a conversation, and Whitaker should remember.
What is the line between the president doing something, as you say, improper, and doing something illegal, obstruction, attempting to obstruct justice? I mean, what? Obviously, there's many things which may be improper and unseemly, which are not actually illegal.
Key question, we need to know more facts. Before we reach any conclusion, we need to know what the president's actual words were, what his intent was to be gleaned from those words. We need to know whether Whitaker took any action at all, how Whitaker interpreted it. We're not likely to know those facts in the next 24 hours. The only way to really obtain them is to have Whitaker back. And Chairman Nadler has been pursuing very assiduously and meticulously an investigation that has historic consequences. The president's potential conversations with Whitaker indicate that he's treating the Department of Justice like his own personal attorneys. And the American public has a right to wonder, why is Whitaker so vague and seemingly disingenuous if there's nothing to hide?
Senator Blumenthal, I appreciate it. Thank you very much.